Okay, if everyone will have a seat, please, we're going to get started in about a minute. All right. Thank you, everyone, for your attention. We're going to start today's July 12th Planning Committee. Believe it or not, it's the Agenda 29. I know those of us on this committee believe that, but it is. This is a public meeting to consider the proposed comprehensive official plan and zoning bylaw amendments listed as items 1, 4, 6, and 7 on today's agenda. For the items listed above, only those who make oral submissions today or written submissions before the amendments are adopted may appeal the matter to the Ontario Municipal Board. In addition, the applicant may appeal the matter to the Ontario Municipal Board if Council does not adopt an amendment within 120 days of receipt of the application for zoning and 180 days for an official plan amendment. And as most of you know, and if you don't, a comment sheet is available over there under that screen for anyone wishing to submit written comments or to sign up to speak. And when you sign up to speak and it's your turn, you have 5 minutes. Thank you. All right. Any declarations of interest from committee members? No? Confirmation of minutes from the meeting of the 28th of June. Is that carried? Thank you. Okay. Our first item was tabled at the last meeting. It's the Kanata North Urban Expansion Study Area, Integrated Official Plan Amendment and Environmental Assessment. As you know, we I closed the door on the public portion and tabled it today for debate and questions. So I'm going to ask Mr. Smith's coming forward, Mr. Collings, and Mr. Chown. Okay, now you may find it's a little bit strange to have Mr. Chown up here at this point, but I'm going to tell you what I didn't know at the last meeting, and which I think if I had known, it would have saved us a lot of time, is that this CDP for the past 3 years has been developer-driven. So therefore, the ownership and the most knowledge of the most difficult questions, and enough, there were interesting questions that I think that Mr. Chown knew. It'll be helpful if we have questions now just to have him here before us. Okay, he led this whole CDP. All right. So, does anyone have any questions? We're open for questions and debate. Councillor Hubley?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I did get a lot of my questions resolved since the last meeting on this issue, and I appreciate it. The only one I have left that I'm not clear on why we're doing it is the park and ride. So do we have somebody here to talk about the park and ride piece? Okay. The part I'm not clear of here is I understand through the exercise there was a report done that said that we could have got a smaller park and ride here because it's only meant for the buses at the end of the loop. We have the new park and ride being built at Innovation that's supposed to be providing all the capacity in that area. Was there not any consideration for having the two put together into one good-sized park and ride?
Through you, Madam Chair. I guess in terms of the park and ride, the location in this part of the city, it was identified already in the city's official plan and the TMP as a result of a park and ride study. There was a couple studies done that OC commissioned, and there was a recommendation to have a park and ride in this community at the southern portion of this community. Through the process, though, we evaluated whether that southern portion, that southern location, was the most appropriate location. It's already in the official plan, it's already in the TMP, and OC Transpo, from a perspective of wanting to have their park and rides typically at the end of line, thought that a much better location would be the northern part of this community. It would serve the rural population better, it would serve the new residents better. And it also works better for routing, especially during rush hour traffic. And so that was the reason why the existing identified park and ride was moved further to the north. In terms of consideration of joining the two, I would have to probably look over to OC Transpo. Genya Stefanoff is here. Maybe she can answer that question in specific detail. But really,
so it's OC that determines the size of the park and rides that they need? Because I'm wondering, I understand the report came back saying that it could have, this one, because it's only dead-ending buses, could have been a whole lot smaller. But someone, either OC Transpo or our staff, upgraded the size of this. And at the same time, we have the innovation. And Councillor Cadre and I have done a lot of work, and it was his idea originally, so I got to give him all the kudos for it. I just worked on it with him, was to get the park and ride open at the Canadian Tire place. And so the question is, where we could have those spots for next to nothing, why are we spending tens of millions of dollars creating a new park and ride and now a spin-off of that new park and ride? So who answers that? You guys or OC?
We'll bring OC up.
Because at some point we're going to have to be accountable to the taxpayer on this.
Well, the conclusions of why we need a park and ride in this location was a result of a couple studies that they did that council has seen, and that's why it was put into the official plan and put in the transport.
The studies from OC Transport.
Well, we worked with them, of course, on that, but yes.
Okay. Okay, so we'll pursue it through there. You're good with that? Okay, we'll pursue that through there. Okay, thank you, Madam Chair.
Okay, does anyone have, we do have a couple of motions on this item, and maybe, and I know I haven't done the consent agenda yet, but we'll do it after we go through this. Does anyone have any questions on the Kanata North CDP for any of the people before us? No? Okay, so let's go introduce the motions. Vice Chair Tierney, we have two. We first of all have one with regard to Carp Road.
That's
Councillor Hubley. Want to introduce that one for Councillor Alshantiri?
The one for Alshantiri first?
Yes, please.
Okay. Here we go. Whereas concerns have been expressed by members of the public regarding the potential increase in traffic along Old Carp Road as a result of the proposed development of the Kanata North Urban Expansion Area, therefore be it resolved that the Kanata North Community Design Plan be amended to require the monitoring of traffic along Old Carp Road once approximately 750 units have been constructed on the west side of March Road within the CTP area. Thank you.
So, Councillor Alshantiri, that is like, just keep an eye on it. Watch out. Okay. And then the second item, the second motion is from Councillor Wilkinson, but she's not on the committee. So, Councillor, are you moving it?
Yeah, okay. I have the newest one. Do you want
No, that's fine. Moved
okay.
by Councillor Hubley.
This I just received at the start of the meeting, so it's been amended. I can't... I don't know if staff have seen it yet, but...
Yes, they have.
Okay. So do you want the whole whereas or just therefore?
Yeah. What it's doing. It speaks to the field house, for example, the parks.
Okay. Do the whole thing. So whereas the proposed community park and the Kanata North Urban Expansion Lands... Pardon me? urban expansion lands is approximately 3.5 kilometers from the Ridgecraft Recreation Complex in Kanata, and whereas the community park preliminary design of FIT plan shows two full-size soccer fields, a double tennis court, play structure, splash pad, puddle rink, boarded rink for hockey and basketball, a shade structure, and two parking lots, but no provision for washrooms or community meeting space. Whereas the project projected population of 8,000 is to be housed on these lands, community meeting place should be provided. Whereas a field house of approximately 2,500 square feet would provide space for washrooms and local community activities, and whereas the CTP includes provisions for a field house provided funds are available, and whereas the city staff indicate that a community association-led application to the community partnership major capital program could be made subject to local fundraising providing for a 50% portion of the cost. Therefore, be it resolved that Figure 3, the FIT plan for the community park, be modified to show a location for a field house of 2,500 square feet, and the description for the community park be amended to include a field house in the park. Construction to be subject to funding for the field house being resolved prior to the construction of the park, failing which the site will be reserved for construction at a later date when funding is obtained. Thank you, Madam Chair.
So before, you have other changes other than that?
Yeah, Mark made a suggestion, which Tim has.
Okay, just a minute, because Vice Chair Tierney has a question, but would one of you show on the map, Councillor Leeper would like to see where this park is?
It's on the west side of March Road. It's the green, the large green park, just immediately south of the high school, the 012.
Vice Chair Tierney?
Yeah, just to clarify.
Question on the motion?
We checked with the clerk as well and with Mel. It's the same motion that you read. Those changes were applied. Yeah, it's there with on the screen.
It wasn't read in with what, it wasn't what I gave to Councillor Hubley because it came after that. So if you just add those words in, they didn't want the whole
thing. They are there.
Yeah, they're there on the screen. I just had a question to staff. So this is basically for futures, I assume, and it would be up to Councillor Wilkinson to raise this money. Is this a practice that we should be doing for all of our planning efforts in the future as councillors, putting these kind of placeholders in there?
It's a possibility. It identifies the possibility of community fundraising to establish a possible need in the future. So all this motion really does right now is reserve a spot on that park for a field house, subject to a future funding initiative. So
I would just add to that, if it's helpful. I did have concerns myself. You know, with the usual things, queue jumping and that sort of thing, and taxpayers' money and that sort of thing, and forcing the hand of the taxpayer, being all of us collectively, to support it because the park was going in. So I did talk to the general manager of Parks and Rec, Dan Chenier, and to Kevin Wary. And so this is what Dan sent me this morning. He said, Councillor, to add to Kevin's note, this is consistent with the direction we received from Council in 2004 when the Recreation Infrastructure Plan was approved that these facilities be contemplated where there is community support and fundraising or an alternate source. For example, Ward, Cash and Lou in the core is the alternative, but that it not place pressure on DCs. Also, the motion reflects the chat I had with Councillor Wilkinson yesterday that the facility be kept of a size not to cause a pressure on the city having to staff it. So a facility of this size would be operated by way of key agreements with user groups, which is the way field houses are. We don't have any staff at Ken Ross Fieldhouse. It was paid for by the user groups, the soccer and the rugby and the football and all that kind of stuff. So there would be no significant pressure on budgets in the FTE. So those are the things that we approved way back in 2004, and that's why he's comfortable in this approach and had a good conversation with the councillor.
Yeah, and thank you for that, Madam Chair, but I think I'm just questioning, without this, would Councillor Wilkin still be able to do this in the future? Or is this just something that we're putting out there to make sure it's part of a record? And I'm asking because in established areas like where I got Ken Steele Park, and now I'm getting Section 37 money to put a bunker in, 25 years after the field was built. if we were to build new fields, like in areas like Councillor Blaze area, where there's expansion like in Councillor Hubley's area, should they be running to this table saying, we want to put a placeholder here that we'll get some fundraising done and we'll build it? Is that a necessary step?
I think it just, the councillor will probably have some comments on this, but I think it provides some clarity.
Dana, can you speak louder, please?
Sorry. I think it provides some clarity in terms of a future desire. And, you know, the park is going to be designed. We have fit plans in the CDP that shows all the facilities within the park. And by identifying that this is a possible space that could be accommodating for a field house, we'll design around that. If the money falls through, it, you know, it'll just be greened or something to that effect. But at least when the design is going forward, we'll be able to reserve a spot for this field house in this park.
Good. Thank you.
Murray, can I just ask you, because you led the process, is this something that you heard, you know, throughout all the meetings that you had? I know you had dozens of meetings.
Certainly the Councillor Wilkinson was at the table throughout this process, and she has raised this a couple of times. Obviously the question of funding was an issue we were struggling with in terms of what we showed on the park fit plans that were included in the CDP that was released to the public and to members of this committee earlier in May. But I think this is a good approach to make sure that there is a location identified on that park fit plan, so if and when funding is available, there actually is room for that facility, which, you know, does make some sense when you got that many people using a park facility. It's nice to know that there's somewhere where you can go.
And it ties into the principles of BBSS too, for sure. So hang on a second. Is that your question? You're done? Okay. I, if you're just doing wrap-up, I have other people with questions. Councillor Leeper? Sure, and then Councillor Blay?
Thanks, and thanks for showing me the location of the park. Can you just position that within whatever active transit or active transportation networks there are? How will people get to it by bike and on foot?
If I can jump in, it might be a little bit faster. There are multi-use pathways located on the inside of the collector roads that surround that park. There are bike lanes on March Road adjacent to that park. And to the north, there's a creek corridor with a recreational trail along it, which would connect to those multi-use pathways or the bicycle tracks on March Roads. And there's a signalized intersection at March Road to provide access to all of the residents on the east side of March Road. So it's a very accessible park by non-vehicular mode of transportation.
I'm wondering, maybe staff can just show me and refresh my memory, where is the signalized intersection?
No, go north. Right at the park. John, it's right at the park in March Road.
Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Right there.
Thank you very much.
Councillor Blay? Councillor Blay?
Yeah, thanks very much. It would be helpful if these motions could get circulated because I've heard them, but sometimes it's nice to read them specifically. I guess my question is, how do we ensure that the notion of reserving space for this facility doesn't then put pressure on either the next round of strategic initiatives or development charge bylaw review to come up with a way to generate funds to build it from the taxpayer as opposed to from the community or from the developer?
I think the motion itself speaks to fundraising, so it's not a DC pressure.
Does it explicitly say that DCs won't be used?
It does. Yeah. Does. Sorry.
I don't have it before me.
This we've had a couple of renditions of this up until the meeting started, but the last part of it does say, do you want to...
that's the last
thing. With regard to the DCs?
Madam Chair, maybe I'll just reread the therefore clause. Therefore, it be resolved in Figure 3, the fit plan for the community park be modified to show the location of the field house of 2,500 square feet and the description for the community park amended to include field house in the park. Construction to be subject to the funding for the field house be resolved prior to construction of the park, failing which the site of the field house would be reserved for construction at a later date when funding is obtained.
Yeah, so, Madam Chair, the operative clause does not speak to fundraising or non-tax or DC money at all. It says construction subject to funding. Construction subject to funding means that if...
So let's tighten that up to reflect more of what Mr. Chenier said, because as what I read, I think, again...
So I guess where I'm going, Madam Chair, is in Cumberland, we had a facility that was on a plan that was shown that there was no plan to fundraise for or to raise money for or to develop in any way, shape, or form, and we created a local development charge to pay for it in partnership with the home builders in the neighborhood to accelerate this. And so I'm not sure why we simply wouldn't write language in that this should be paid for through an area-specific development charge restricted to the community that we're talking about.
So here's what I'm going to suggest. Yes?
I have the motion in front of me now. I didn't before. It just got circulated. It's the last whereas. Whereas city's staff indicated that a community association-led application to the community partnership major capital program should be made, subject to local fundraising, providing 50% portion of the cost. Yeah,
Mr. Mark, could I also not add a whereas? The sky is purple. Like the whereases, as I understand, don't actually reflect.
Here's my suggestion. I'm actually just sending the email that I received from Mr. Chenier this morning to Mr. Mark and asking if you can take the real points here, which include DC comments, significant pressure on budgets or FTEs, that sort of thing, and incorporate it into this motion, the last rendition of the motion that has been read into on the floor. And while we're doing that, can we just table this again. I'll go through the consent agenda while he's looking at that, and we'll come back. I think that we're all on, we want the opportunity, Parks and Recreation asked Council back in 2004, should we have an opportunity? Sure we should. I mean, wish we all were doing that, but the fact is we have to be very careful that there's no queue jumping, which I said in the beginning, and that there isn't a take of development charges that really it's not in the lineup to have at that point, so we know where those things are being spent. But clearly, an opportunity for Councillor Wilkinson or whomever is the councillor of the day when that happens to have a place that is in the park so that it's not being used for something else. An opportunity missed is basically what Mr. Chenier is talking about. If you miss the opportunity, you will never have it. And this is just preserving the opportunity, and if you can, but it should not be dependent on building the park has to have the field house or the funding has to be tied to it. And that's what I hope that Mr. Mark will come up with. Then go and talk to him, because we're going to table it and we're going to go with our consent agenda. Okay, so we table that again. So item number two is the highway name change application, Nortel Drive in Barrhaven to Citygate Drive. Is that carried? Okay, and then we have the development charge complaint, 300 Greenbank Road. There's a request that we defer that to the August 23rd meeting. And if you have any questions, maybe talk to Mr. Mizzi or Tim. Oh, yeah, sorry, it's Tim. It's Tim's in between now and the 23rd. So that's deferred. You want to do the motion?
Therefore, it be resolved that the report, development charge complaint, 300 Greenbank Road, be deferred to the 23rd of August, 2016 Planning Committee meeting to rise to Council for consideration on the 14th of September. Therefore, it further be resolved that staff be directed to review and modify the financial implications of this section of the report as needed prior to the release of the agenda for the 23rd of August, 2016 Planning Committee.
Carried. Okay, then the next item is zoning bylaw amendment, part of 570 Hazeldine Road. Where's my list of... Okay, we have one speaker here, Paul Hicks from FOTEN representing Mattamy. Does anyone have any questions on this item? You do? Do I have to, you want to hold it then? Well, then hang on a sec. Sure. We're going to, Mr. Hicks, where are you? Okay, hang on a second. We're going to have a comment from Councillor Hubley.
Thank you, Madam Chair, for your indulgence. I want to put on the record that I met with staff, the developer, and the councillor. There's some traffic issues that come up in the public meeting that we are going to make an adjustment to Castle Frank Road to address. It's not here in the motion, but we'll pick it up in the detailed planning piece of the work, and that involves both number 4 and number 6. It's the houses involved in both. So if that's okay, Madam Chair?
Sure.
Thank you.
Okay, so Mr. Hicks,
Madam Chair, I do have a motion.
I know. The motion to move it tomorrow?
No. It's a technical amendment.
Yes, right. Okay, hang on a second. So, Mr. Hicks, if the committee is willing to carry this item, do you still need to speak?
I don't.
Okay, fine. So we have a technical error that was on the original report requiring this report. So, Councillor Kadri?
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. And just a technical amendment, like you mentioned, there was an error in the original report. And basically what it says is that whereas the omission and technical errors have adversely impacted the applicant's ability to construct a sales office and model home to allow seasonal sales and construction, therefore be it resolved that the report AC's S2016 program 0123 zoning bylaw amendment part of 570 Hazeldene will proceed to council on July 13th. And be it further resolved that there be no further notice pursuant to Section 3417 of the Planning Act. That's technical.
Is that motion carried? Carried. And so on this item, is it carried? Thank you. Next item is application to alter Somerset House, 352 Somerset Street. We're going to hold that item. And the next item is 950 Terry Fox Drive and part of the unaddressed parcel immediately to the north. Okay, we have one speaker here. This is, and Greg Winters from Novatech. Where are you, Greg? Okay. If, I know you have a motion to move it. Oh, sorry.
Madam Chair, I just wanted to make a comment based on Councillor Hubley's comment about the traffic on the...
Okay, hang on a second.
Sure.
So, Mr. Winters, if the committee is willing to carry this item, do you need to speak? Okay, thanks very much. Councillor Kadri, to talk about traffic again.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, and I do want to thank Councillor Hubley for the concerns that he's raised about the traffic flow at this intersection when this gets connected to Castle Frank. Both Councillor Hubley and some of the staff, we've had discussions on this traffic issue, and we will work together to resolve the traffic concern that Councillor Hubley has expressed.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? And I know that Councillor Kadri has a motion to move this to council agenda tomorrow because of the technical problem that we, error that we missed. There was a 4-week delay, and so it's added time, and we wanted to assist with the sales office, which is ready to go, and having it allowed to be constructed. So, normally, because we're dealing with it today, it would have been on August the 31st, but Councillor Kadri has a motion to move that to council tomorrow, which we'll deal with right after we carry the item. Is the item carried? Okay, now your motion to move it to council tomorrow.
Thank you again, Madam Chair. And again, it's therefore be resolved that report ACS 2016-0121, Zoning Bylaw Amendment 950 Terry Fox Drive and part of unaddressed parcel to the north proceed to City Council on July 13th, 2016, and be it further resolved that there be no further notice pursuant to Section 3417 of the Planning Act.
Thank you. Is that carried? So the next item is 318 Lisgar Street, Zoning Bylaw Amendment, recommending Council approve an amendment to Zoning Bylaw 2008-250 for 318 Lisgar Street to rezone the entire property to permit an office use and to amend the vehicle parking provisions as detailed in Document 2. We do have Stephanie Morris is here. She's a planner with Holzman Consultants. Hang on a second. Where are you? Oh, over there in the corner. Thank you. Does anyone have any questions on 318 Lisgar Street? Okay, so if committee is prepared to carry this item, do you still need to speak? Okay, thanks very much. So is the item carried? Thank you. Okay, Built Heritage Subcommittee had this before them, the update on the Strategic Initiative 42, which was the Heritage Inventory Project, Phase 1, inside the Greenbelt, long overdue. Does anyone want to hold that, or is it carried? Received, sorry. Sure.
Just a quick comment on that to thank staff for the significant work that they've been doing, outreaching to the community itself and taking advantage of the expertise that's in some of our neighborhoods with respect to the inventory that we have. I'm very impressed with where they're going with this.
Good. And kudos to Chair Nussbaum, who chairs the Build Heritage Subcommittee. And the real fun will begin when we go to the rural area.
If folks are interested, the staff, including the two research assistants who were hired for this project, did an interesting presentation at BHSC yesterday. That deck is available for those
of
you
who have interest. Why don't you post it on the city's website where we capture heritage items?
I'll do that.
Reports. Yeah. That would be good. Then everybody can see it. I also wanted to ask you, are you having any kind of a tour this fall?
So consultations are underway on choosing a location. We haven't done so yet, but stay tuned.
Well, we know where we haven't been yet.
That's right.
So we shouldn't have repeats. And we definitely should go out to Rito Goulburn, probably. See a few barns. Okay. Maybe a red one or something. Permanent signs on property, private property bylaw review is item number 9. And we do have a speaker, so we're holding that. Number 10 is status update planning committee inquiries and motions for the period ending 30th of June, 2016. Is that item received? Okay. Item number 11 is waiver to permanent signs on private property bylaw with regard to a mural at 595 Gladstone. Okay. So is that item approved?
Carried.
No, carried. And so now we have a motion to send it to council tomorrow because they want to have an event in August, so we kind of have to deal with it at council before that event.
Yeah, so therefore it be resolved that the report waive the permanent sign by, let me finish, the permanent sign private property bylaw mural at 595 Gladstone Avenue proceed to City Council on the 13th of July 2016.
Carried. Thank you. All right. And then the last item was an information previously distributed, the building permit applications. Okay, so are we good to come back, Mr. Mark, to item number 1 with additions to the Fieldhouse motion that will cover the DC issue and committing future funding? Mr. Mark?
Chair, the wording that I had come up with, and I don't know if Council Wilkinson and Council Blay had a chance to see it on their screens, is further be it resolved that the funding is to include 50% raised through community support and fundraising, ward, cash in lieu of parkland, area-specific development charges, or other alternative non-tax.
Committee coordinator does not have it, and so she would like to have it so she can put it on the screen, please. Sorry, Mr. Mark, go ahead. It's before you on the screen now, everybody. It's amazing you have to go through all of that to get it there. Okay. Okay, it's on the screen now. Everybody wants to have a look at it. Mr. Mark, sorry for that. Can you move it up to the...
So, Madam Chair, the ending essentially would allow for alternative funding sources other than non-tax, non-general development charge sources for 50% of the cost of the project.
I think the issue is that the door shouldn't be open for using...
Yeah, it's not on the screen, Councillor Hubis is, but I think I get the gist, Mr. Mark. If your version, though, is approved, are we not effectively approving in advance a major capital grant application? We're saying we'll give you the money as long as you raise half. We're saying that today as opposed to 6 or 7 or 8 or 10 years from now. Who knows if the major capital program will even exist then?
Madam Chair, my understanding of the motion as a whole comprehends the fact that there may not be a budget for the field house because it speaks to when the park is constructed, the funds aren't identified, and then it speaks to being addressed at a later date. And it being addressed at a later date may mean that the funding isn't approved. So I would not read the motion as approving funding for the field house in advance.
Okay.
Yeah, I want to wait.
Okay, you know what? Honestly, I got to say, this is embarrassing. Okay, it's very embarrassing. We're not clearly, and I think you spoke to it at the beginning when you said if we had these motions ahead of time, this is not a staff problem. This is a lack of coordination problem, and I don't like flying by the seat of our pants. Okay, so we're just going to take a 5-minute recess. Okay, so anybody wants to go and have a sip of water or take a walk around the hallway there. We're going to come back. We're going to have everything right before us. The right stuff's going to be on the screen. That's no fault at all to Ms. Dufanet here and her staff or to anybody. Okay? But this is a big item. We've worked on it for 3 years. It could mean that there'll be more questions, so the three of you just stay there and relax. Okay. So, okay, everybody. Yes, I know. All right. Everybody, have a seat. Okay, don't worry too much about this, because Councillor Blay, I think, has got a good way to go. All right? Everybody ready? Everybody? Good? This is a CDP that took 3 years. Just saying. Right? Okay. Good that it took 3 years? Good that it took 3 years? Yeah. A lot has been, tires have been kicked and everything else. We're in the final stages now. Let's make sure we get it right. Councillor Blake.
Okay, I guess the larger concern, certainly for a growth area like mine, is that we have not reviewed our long-term plan for building community facilities and rec facilities in, about 12 years or so. And in that time, thousands of hectares of new land have been brought into the urban boundary. And as I understand it, there is no plan beyond the next rec center. There really is no plan as to what should come next, where it should go. We've had development inside the core as well, and there's probably a need in that part of the city. And so my concern with establishing these without any kind of funding criteria is that they'll be elevated to the top of that list whenever that new version of that plan comes about. And I expect we're going to have to get into that fairly soon, otherwise we're not going to be able to collect development charges for them. And so I appreciate the efforts that have gone into adjusting the motion, but given that we don't have a long-term plan for community buildings and rec facilities, I'm just not sure that I can support randomly throwing one in the absence of that citywide plan for their construction and maintenance and operating.
But you had an idea on...
Well,
on
we could make this particular facility conditional on being approved in some form of that plan that would come forward in the future.
And so that would be... and we think it's next year that that's coming forward. It's long overdue, for sure. I mean, we've... You know, if there's an area that we have not we have not had the time spent since amalgamation, it's certainly the Parks and Recreation with regard to what we're talking about, right? That's information that we need to have. So are you going to, would you recommend that that be a friendly?
If it's a friendly amendment, I'd have
to
add that to the motion.
To the motion, which would be, this is the motion, these are the criteria, but when we review the facilities plan, the master plan with Parks and Rec in 2017 or whenever it is, it's in this term, that consideration be given there, and at that time that they'll do the due diligence on, is there a need for this field house? Should it be a priority? Is there a need in the general area? Can it be satisfied another way? So we would go with this motion, add on the and
subject to confirmation through XXX process for long-term capital recreational
facilities.
Requirements or something like that.
Yeah.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
There seems to be several versions of this, and frankly, the last minute bringing it here, all the changes, it's turned into a real bird's nest at this point. So I'd like to call a question yeas and nays on this one.
Well, you can't, because we're in the throes of having his motion typed onto it. So that would be the one. That would be yeas and nays on what he was just adding. That's fine. You can do yeas and nays.
So on the actual motion itself?
Yeah, on the actual motion with what he just put on the floor, which is the... And that all of these rules that have been in place with regard to this one location and this one field house in this one place, that it be part of the consideration of the facilities master plan, which is being updated. I don't think we can put more conditions on it than that. At the very end, it might mean that Councillor Wilkinson is once again going with a local improvement charge or something like that. I mean, we don't know that, but it's unlikely. We're talking it's a field house. And usually, how many people have field houses? These things are driven by the sports groups that are using the fields. They come up with a large part of the money. So,
I just clarify, Ms. Chair, so what you're saying is the motion would stand as is with this additional clause that Councillor Blais has brought forward?
As is with all of the conditions
that as I have
added.
No problem with that. In the meantime, if I wanted to get it going quickly.
But we have before us now
yeas
and
nays. We can still fundraise to do it. It doesn't stop that from happening in the interim.
You're going to have to do that. That's already included. It's still included.
And there's a number of ways
the
to
only
do
thing
that.
That's different is that. Well, a lot of things are different since we took the break. We've tightened up very much where the funding is going to come from. There's not going to be an expectation that everybody in this city is going to be paying for it, or that it's going to queue jump, or that it's going to usurp anybody else's ability to get funding, et cetera, et cetera. And so what has been added, and that this proposal be conditional on the facilities master plan review, which is a very big process, but we know it will be in this term. And definitely, you can bet, that if we approve this thing, then you have to go to plans of subdivisions and things like little things like that. The park is not going to be built in the same in that time frame. Take it to the bank. No, we're on yeas and nays.
No, before we do that, Madam Chair, the last paragraph is added. It says, and this proposal will be conditional on the facilities master plan review. That means that the master plan review says we don't need it. I can't even fundraise for it.
No,
Madam Chair, this is going to be version six of this. This is a complete mess, and I'm calling yeas and nays on the motion period, and I suggest to my colleagues we vote it down.
Well, if you vote it down, then we have
Councillor Wilkinson, we had yeas and nays before.
It's in the plan.
Councillor Wilkinson, he put the call to vote on this motion, okay? So on the motion, which is about this park in the future of sports fields likely to have the ability to have a field house on site when it becomes affordable through very strict ways, and that this proposal be conditional on the facilities master plan review. That's the only new part that's been added to it. We're calling the vote. That means we don't discuss it anymore.
For those of you
that don't know that.
I'm not discussing, and I don't
know.
I have a right to make a request.
No, you don't. Not when the vote has been put. You don't.
I can ask.
Okay, the vote has been put.
Madam Chair.
The vote has been put.
I am challenging your ruling.
Okay. Challenge the chair. That the chair is
challenged.
And
I have time to introduce why
I'm
challenging.
No, you don't. No, you don't. He's challenging the chair on my right to go to the vote that was called, the vote that was put by the vice chair. On the motion, the final part was put in by Councillor Blake. Shall the chair be sustained?
Yes.
Okay. Councillor Blake?
Yes.
Councillor Brockington?
No.
Councillor Shirelli?
Yes.
Councillor Cloutier?
Yes.
Councillor Hubley?
No.
Councillor Leeper?
No.
Councillor Nussbaum?
Yes.
Councillor Kadri?
Yes.
Vice Chair Tierney?
Yes.
I'm not voting on myself. 7-3. Okay. So now on the vote itself, on this motion, which everybody has before them. Wait a minute. It's not before us again. The good thing is we've had enough discussion that we know what it is that we're doing that's before us. And we have the wording in place that determines that. Okay, and before the next meeting, since we have a break, we're going to go over some of this and make it easier for our committee coordinator to actually be able to operate within our system. Because quite frankly, it's embarrassing and it's ridiculous. But then again, when we have all this stuff coming at us at the last minute, which even though we tried very hard to prepare for this committee, and we meet, you know, for the agenda review so that we're sure that we have all the motions and that sort of thing, today we have a problem. Okay, now it's on the screen. The most, pardon? Yeas and nays have been put. Councillor Blais?
Yes.
Councillor Brockington?
I'm not voting on this matter.
Then you have to leave the table. Councillor Shirelli?
No.
Councillor Cloutier?
Yes.
Councillor Hubley?
Yes.
Is that two votes? Councilor Gleeper?
Yes.
Councilor Nussbaum?
Yes.
Councilor Kadri?
Yes.
Vice Chair Tierney?
No.
And myself, yes. 7-2 Okay, you got a lot of work ahead of you. Councilor Wilkinson, but.
Add another.
Okay,
this is a.
Let's not get. No, we're not adding anything more.
I just will tell you, I've talked to the lawyer about whether that restricts us from fundraising for it, and we're going to check, and if there is, we may have a minor change tomorrow.
That'll be up to you. I suggest that you don't have any changes tomorrow. Councilor Alshantiri wants to say something?
I would like to say something, if I may. Because I think it needs to be said. We work on this for 3 years with a group of volunteers in our community. And I think it will be hard-pressed not to recognize their effort. They opened their homes, their houses, to have us meeting in their homes. And we had 19 meetings, and I can tell you the attendance was almost full every time. I don't think too many of committee members was absent from all those meetings. And to come in here in the last minute is heartbreaking to see how we dealt with it. But I just want to go on record. The committee we work with, the staff, and even the developer who had Novatec working with us, they did a tremendous job, and that should go on record. Thank you very much.
Thank you, and well said. So we have voted on the item of the motion, We still have the item before us to finish speaking to. Hang on a second. I'm going to offer first to Councillor Brockington. Do you want to speak to the item itself? No, we voted on the motion with regard to the field house. That's all we voted for.
No, not at this time, Madam
Okay.
Chair. I understand this item's coming to council tomorrow.
Yeah, well, we have to vote on that, too.
Okay, all right, thank you.
We're not done with this yet. Do we have all the motions on the table yet? We had that on the table. I mean, is everything on the table that we have on motions, with the exception of it moving to council tomorrow? Yes? I'm asking again, yes? That you know of? You have the motion. So your motion, anyone want to say anything before we get to the motions? That'll be right now. Yeah. Yes. Then, you know what, you may want to hold off because he has a clarification. Councillor Hubley.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to give the staff an opportunity to clarify the earlier discussion around the park and rides, that how the decision came about to go with two separate park and rides, if you don't mind.
Yes. We clarified a little bit some earlier comments that were made. There's a study right here. It's a 2009 study that was conducted by the Planning Department, our transportation branch, with significant input from OC Transport, but they were the lead on that study, which was then fed into the TMP and the OPA.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Okay, over to you. And anyone else want to speak on this item before I and Councillor Alshantiri has already done his wrap-up. Well said. And Councillor Wilkinson for wrap-up.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. Just to clarify, on the field house is actually in the wording of the TMP. All I was trying to clarify is to make sure the map that they showed it. And it got a little bit out of hand, I think. So thank you for actually putting it through the lines. It was just a case of something that has been demanded by the community. The developer didn't want to pay the DC. I'll still work on that because I think it's the best way to fund it. But the I think having things in the community, knowing ahead of time. I have three parks that I'm doing this with. One in Arcadia, they didn't have enough money, because there's not enough money in the park budgets to actually do everything that you really need to do for a community, especially an isolated community. And we're fundraising for a splash pad, but we put the location in the plan so we could do it afterwards. And that's exactly what I was trying to do here. The actual process was an incredibly difficult and complicated process. It didn't seem that way when we started, but when you have 3 2-acre lot developments in addition to it, we have people who paid surcharges because they backed onto farmland that were backing onto it. We had creeks through it. We have a major road right through the middle of it, which sort of breaks almost like the Queensway effectively. And we have old forest roads, which are very narrow, like the old Carp Road, which have very serious implications if a lot of traffic starts going on them. So I want to say that the community members of the group were particularly good in bringing forward ideas. They really put a lot of effort into it. Very smart, bright people that came forward to give up a huge amount of their time, because we had a lot of meetings to do that. And the staff that worked on it, both Wendy from Spanning and Murray and his staff from the consulting office, were very open to having additional meetings. When we went to people's homes, they usually actually fed us as well, which is always nice at a meeting. But the from that, we were able to resolve most of the very thorny issues of how you, when you have an area that's been a designated rural and now it's urban, how do you make that adjustment? And so that's why it took so much time. And the servicing is complicated as well. And I think what's come out of that is with the meets most of those objectives. There's still a few things that people would have liked to have seen which you can't see, but that happens in every plan. And so I want to commend them for doing that, and I thank the Planning Committee for dealing with it. We found it was complicated because it kept changing. I'll tell you, over the 3 years, it kept changing too. I'm not sure. What did we end up with? What plan number?
27.
We did 27 different plans. So it gives you an indication of how much had to go into this. So I want to thank you for approving it today and sending it on tomorrow. And we're now going into the next phase, which will be development, which is going to be even probably more difficult.
Okay. So thank you very much. You've heard the two local councillors that have been engaged in this, and we heard from a couple of the neighbors that were engaged last committee meeting, but we also had a very good letter all of us received from John. What's John's last name, Eli?
Horowitz.
What? John who?
Horowitz.
Yes. Sorry, Murray. It was an excellent letter. It was very positive and talked about how pleased they were with the process and all the opportunity that they had for input. So that's very good when that happens. And anyway, so on the item, Hubley's motion, sure. The Carp Road on behalf of Councillor Alshantieri, is that carried? That's just monitoring Carp Road, just to remind you. That's carried. And then on the item as amended, and then we have another motion after that. On the item as amended, carried with the also with the park, with the field house, and now the monitoring. And now, Vice Chair Tierney.
Great. Thank you, Madam Chair. Therefore, be resolved that the original report recommendations be deleted and replaced with the following. That Planning Committee recommends to Council, 1, approve the Kanata North Community Design Plan, the Transportation Master Plan, the Environment Management Plan, and the Master Servicing Plan, which are dated June 28, 2016, and were submitted under a separate cover. And, 2, approve official plan amendment number of the City of Ottawa official plan dated June 24th, 2016 to implement the community design plan.
Okay. So is that carried? And now with that change, we have to vote on the report as amended again. Never again is what I'm saying. Again, carried?
Carried.
Okay, now we have one more.
This is easier. This is therefore be resolved that the report, Kanata North Urban Expansion Area Integrated Official Plan Amendment and Environmental Assessment, proceed to City Council on July 13th, 2016, as originally scheduled.
At the last meeting, when we tabled it, I said that we would have it before us for debate today and that we would have it go to Council tomorrow. So if you don't want to vote for it, don't vote for it, but that's why that's before us right now.
And just as a correction, Madam Chair.
The motion, so you can go yays and nays.
The motion actually on the screen does contain that information within the whereases. Thank you.
Okay. Do you want yays and nays on this, or are you just going to dissent? Dissent? Carried?
Carried.
Thank you, everybody. Been as torturous as it was. That's why you like me, because I'm honest? Okay. So thank you, everybody. Going now to application to alter Somerset House at 352 Somerset Street through the removal of the two easterly bays and a portion of the third bay to be determined through further analysis on the north facade. Now, coincidentally, this item was before Built Heritage Subcommittee yesterday, which it's rare when the two are bumped up so closely against each other. We do have Ms. Coots coming up for comments for questions. Anybody has questions? We do have some. We do have Mr. Frank Padin, and we have some speakers. Okay. Did you want to do any introductory comments, Chair Nussbaum? And then I'm going, just so you know, I'm going to go to all of you if you have any questions before the delegation. I know that's not the way we usually do it, but that's what we're going to do today. I can do that too, but I'm going to actually, I'm actually asking Councillor Nussbaum to do that in his role as the chair.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, just for those, well, everyone actually, who wasn't at the committee meeting yesterday. We did receive a presentation from staff. There were public delegations. I think the feeling around the committee table was one of frustration, mostly, that we were in the situation of really confronting a request for a heritage permit to demolish the structure that people would have preferred had not been before the committee. So a fair bit of hand-wringing about ensuring that this type of situation doesn't arise again, and talking and trying to understand a little bit the history of the file, which is fairly complex in terms of how we got to this day. The essence is that because of two engineering reports, the north wall, so a section of the sort of second structure, the more easterly structure, that north wall is going to have to be demolished if the committee and council approve the request for a heritage permit, as well as the fourth bay of the original three-story structure. And now, one thing just to note, Madam Chair, is as a result of an amendment that came from the Vice Chair yesterday, which the committee supported, there are a few additional conditions that are attached to the staff report before us, essentially to ensure that the owner records, particularly the fourth bay of that existing structure, that the owner stores the material as it's demolished if council approves the heritage permit, and that every attempt be made to reconstruct that fourth bay of the original house using those same materials. So that's the gist of the amended motion, which is before Planning Committee today. Maybe I'll stop there.
That's a good synopsis. So, Ms. Coots, did you want to just do a brief presentation you have there? Do you have it set up to go?
Yes, thank you.
I think there's an interest in it. I was hearing that from this side.
Madam Chair, then I'll go. Just quickly then, this is a building that's contained within the contained within the Centretown Heritage Conservation District at the corner of Somerset and Bank Streets. It was constructed in two phases. The portion facing Bank Street in the turn of the century, or the 19th century, and the portion to the rear, which is what we're talking about today, about 10 years later. Currently, the building is unoccupied. It has been since it collapsed as a result of a construction mishap in the 10 years ago. A large portion of the building was demolished, and pieces of it were the rear part, which is we're discussing today, has been held up by a steel frame since that time. There you can see the steel frame. So what we're talking about today for removal, as the councillor so helpfully pointed out, is, I can't make this work, oh, there we go, is the demolition of this portion and perhaps what we are calling the controlled demolition of this portion, depending on its condition, and the rebuilding of this.
Again, these pictures were taken on Saturday, so it is the most recent. Again, it's designated under the Heritage Act. The application is to remove a piece of the north wall. Again, every one of the recommendations in front of you today is conditional upon the concurrence of the chief building official, because the process leading to the issuance of a permit for the demolition of those walls is going to be complicated. So we want to make sure that we're working together and that it is actually safe and possible to remove the sections. Again, more pictures. This is the bay that isn't supported from the outside, showing its condition. And then, again, this is the portion that's supported on both sides. This has been supported since 2008. There is no roof on this part of the building, and there hasn't been since the construction incident. So it has been waiting to be reintegrated, or it's been waiting since it was since 2007. Again, and then there's also a recommendation for some foundation work. We've asked also, and it was further elucidated in the motions that were passed yesterday that Councillor Nussbaum helpfully told us about, so retaining historic building materials where possible. These could include the sills and lintels and bricks and cornice of this area to be reused not only in its rebuilding but also throughout the restoration of the property. Again, and in our standard conditions. There are engineering reports, one commissioned by the property owner and one is by the deputy city building official that we used to evaluate the application. They concluded that the building was in poor condition and that the easterly three bays could not be saved and the fourth bay, the three-story bay, would be difficult. Again, why we're recommending that this is done in concurrence with the chief building official. We consulted Heritage Ottawa, neighbors, Centretown citizens, and the ward councillor. The ward councillor stated that she was pleased that some action is being taken, but was disappointed that the building had deteriorated to this point. We support the planning and growth management supports the application because it responds to concerns regarding the safety of the walls, provides the option of rebuilding one bay of the building, and also, most importantly, it stabilizes the building and in a way that it will be safe from the elements, and so it can be adapted and reused, because the long-term goal of the property owner and planning and growth management is to have this building once again a vital part of the Centretown Heritage Conservation District to be adapted and reused with as much of the heritage character of the building as possible conserved there. The Bank Street facade continues to be in fair condition. There has been restoration work undertaken there and that will continue. So again, the long-term goal going forward is to have this building back again as a vital part of the Heritage Conservation District. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Coutts. So before us we have Ms. Coutts, who is our senior heritage planner. That makes you sound old. Come to think about it.
Coordinator. So it doesn't make me sound so old.
So you're the heritage coordinator. That's your official role. And Matthew Graham and Frank Bedin. Matthew is manager of inspections and Frank is our acting chief building officer. Okay. So these are the people that are going to answer your questions, and we will have two speakers on this item. But first of all, if you have any questions at a high level, just quick questions, and then any other questions, obviously, that you want to interject when the delegations are speaking. Councillor Cloutier.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Can you just situate for me, in 2008, there was construction that caused the collapse. What was the purpose of the construction? Can you?
The purpose of the construction?
In 2008.
That was the beginning of the restoration of the projects. When that work was undertaken, it was to begin to adapt and reuse the project. And then there was a mishap and work without permits, and that's what caused the building to collapse.
So there was work without permits at that time?
That's my understanding. I can defer to my colleagues.
And at a very high level, and if you'll indulge me, Madam Chair, at a very high level, what work has been done since 2008 to now to maintain or advance this project?
After the collapse, the building was stabilized. The frame that you see in this picture was installed. And then subsequent to that, there have been recently two building permits issued, one for foundation work and one to do a facade restoration, which was commenced and has been partially completed. And in 2013, there was an application to do a large addition to the rear of the building, and a heritage permit was issued by City Council to do that, but that permit was not acted upon.
Okay. And my last one, Madam Chair, this is before us today because in the reports, it uses the term imminent safety concerns, and it uses 60 days, that we need to do something within 60 days. Is that correct, Mr. Bidden? Okay, those are my first questions, just to situate us. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. That's a good question. Councillor Brockington?
Hasn't the owner always wanted a demolition of this building? Isn't this what they want?
The owner has applied for repair and restoration work and for an application to alter under the Heritage Act since its collapse. So, and this is another in a series of permits to save the building and reuse it.
But this building has basically sat vacant and deteriorated for 9 years. I have eyesores in my ward as well, and I'm told as long as there is continuous work that's not between prolonged periods of non-work, that there's actually progress going on, the bylaw will not take action against that property. So I'm struggling to understand how we've permitted this to happen for 9 years. I don't see, you had mentioned the permit being issued in 2013, that there may have been some evidence that they were ready to move forward. But because nothing has happened for 9 years, we're now at a point where the building, the foundation and walls can't be saved. And so I'm struggling to understand how the City of Ottawa permits this to happen, why there weren't sort of stricter requirements asking them to move things along in order to preserve the heritage components. So can I get a better understanding? And then I have a follow-up question about the materials that will be salvaged.
We're not empowered to make work happen. I mean, if they apply for permit and they're doing work and it's moving ahead, that's one thing. There's the power of the order to remedy unsafe buildings. So we make sure that there's enough work done in order to maintain public safety. But it's the building is owned by TKS Holdings, and they're the ones that have to execute the work. So the powers in the building codes, you know, it says that you have to start the work within 6 months, and you can't leave it unattended for longer than a year. So in terms of permits, you can start it, and you can poke away for 10, 20 years. There's no end limit to any of that work. So we're sort of stuck with that legislation.
And just, there's a, Madam Chair, item 5 on the motion talks about where possible, the applicant will be required to clean and store bricks, stone elements, decorative metal. How do we enforce that? How do we ensure that actually gets done?
Sorry, I missed part of your question. Can you just repeat it?
Part of the motion talks about that the existing materials, if they're salvageable, will be reused for the permanent build. How do I make sure that the city is actually monitoring that to make sure they are preserving brick, metal?
That'll be part of the process that will come forward from the engineers. We're going to ask them to provide us with a process and a mechanism of how they plan to, you know, retain, keep, and store some of those materials, whether they're going to store them on site. Like the front part of the building is, in fact, heated. So if they've got room, they can store them in there. But we haven't come to terms with that yet, but certainly that is part of the process.
Yeah, it might be a good time to, Frank, to, you know, talk about, we've talked about having a report come back further to our discussion today, towards the end of September, likely. Ms. Frank, you know, we was asked, you know, do you think that we have the tools? Do we have to go to the province and lobby the province to have more tools? Frank, did you want to speak to that?
Thank you, Madam Chair. No question that I believe we have the tools right now in terms of being able to move forward. You know, we have an action plan moving forward with this particular building. It's a very unique situation with respect to the ownership and, more importantly, the passage of time. Passage of time has been great. And there's been a lot of dreams and wishes of the owner to be able to move forward. He just has not been able to undertake those. Clearly, from one aspect, we want to be able to issue some orders, and we want to be able to make the building permit or make the owner compliant. And where he doesn't, we're gonna hold his feet to the fire per se. I think in the future, I think there needs to be also maybe some further investigation, as mentioned by Chair Harder, regarding the ability through using maybe a planning mechanism. Need to investigate that a little bit further. These are some ideas that we currently are holding, and we'd like to investigate. And the idea here is that through a planning application, there's an opportunity to potentially hold, to potentially have securities. Not sure yet. Would like to fill this one out.
Yeah. So the bottom line is we're going to explore that, because over the last few days we've had discussions about how can we do more? How can we say that we're going to have property standards to do this when people that are seeing heritage properties and that are saying, wait a minute, I thought, shouldn't you be able to do this and shouldn't you be able to do that, when in fact we can't? So our chief building inspector says that he believes that we have the right parts, and we just have to be better coordinated and working together. I think we need to understand, from my perspective anyways, how the financial push will force the actions that we need as well. What that looks like, what we can do. So there's a legal process that's going to have to be involved. And if we can be ready, I've tasked them with by the end of September. I think that's reasonable. If they have to wait till October, we'll wait for that. But we're going to have something that's much tighter to the best of our abilities than usually, and probably some financial pressures as well that will likely change. Will be our best shot at change for sure. Okay, but I'm satisfied when staff say that this is not something we can shove to the province or for legislative changes, because we just need to understand what our rights are, and then we have to coordinate internally. So it's a good time to be doing that. Anybody, Councillor Leeper, and then we're going to go to our first delegation, who is Maurice Quinn.
A quick follow-up to Councillor Brockington's question. In Condition 5 or Recommendation 5, it uses that really subjective term, where possible. So, impose as a term and condition on said approvals that where possible the applicant be required to clean and store bricks, etc. Whose determination is that as to whether it's possible or not? Is that our interpretation, or is that a discussion between the developer and ourselves?
Madam Chair, Recommendation 5 is augmented by 10 that was passed yesterday at the Belt Heritage Subcommittee, because, and it says that matching new materials if deemed necessary through peer review by an independent qualified heritage consultant. So basically the idea is that certainly the brick might all be in bad condition, but it won't be the owner and it won't be heritage staff, because we're not experts. It will be an independent person who will say that yes, this can be reused, etc. So if you read 5 in conjunction with 10, I think that we have a sufficient level of scrutiny about what materials could be reused.
Who's hiring that independent expert?
Consultant approved by the City of Ottawa.
But who's hiring them? Who's paying?
Perhaps Councillor Nussbaum can help me on that from the Bills Registry.
So the intent was this would be done by the City of Ottawa. One of the discussion points is we would want the payment for the services of that person to be charged back to the owner of that property, and that's something we still need to work out. But the idea is to remove the decision-making from the owner of the property and have someone who's independent from them making the decision.
So we'll have this mechanism in place of an independent expert who is intended to be paid for by the applicant, but we haven't got that nailed down yet?
Well, if you look at Section 9, so the idea is that the Chief Building Inspector mentioned securities. Okay. Well, we've put into this motion that a security needs to be paid, okay, as determined by the staff, to ensure the preservation of original materials retained from the demolition. And I think the hope would be that from that security or bond that's paid, any additional costs, i.e. inspecting the brick to see if it can be reused, could possibly be paid out of that security.
Should we be nailing that down today before passing this? Not that it's a huge amount. I mean, I imagine an independent expert might cost us $20,000 or something by the time this is done, but okay. I'll defer to the chair's.
So direction, that can be direction to direction, staff. Frank's shaking his head.
So staff will take that as direction?
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you. So and our first delegation we is Maurice Morris or Maurice Quinn. And you're an engineer with Capacity Engineering. Welcome.
So, effectively, I'm here because Sally suggested that I be here for you to be able to ask questions. And yesterday we had a number of questions or points that came up from the councillors that I thought would be best to clarify. So I can either speak to those, or if you have questions right away, I can take those first.
I think we'll go to questions from this committee. And I know that some people, even though they weren't at the committee yesterday, like my office, we were following the Built Heritage Committee online, as we can do. And so are you employed by the City of Ottawa?
No, I'm the engineer for the owner.
The engineer for the owner. So that's important. Does anybody have any questions of the engineer? No? Did you have a few comments you'd like to make then?
I do. Yesterday there were 5 points that were raised that we never really addressed. Effectively, there were some concerns raised that the owner may not intend to restore this building. I can assure the councillors that he is indeed looking to restore the building. He's done a very good job of restoring other heritage buildings. I think there were people here yesterday from Heritage Ottawa who would agree with that statement. I shouldn't speak for them, but a number of structures, including one he recently did on Gladstone, are in very, very good condition. The protection of the structure that was afforded, I don't believe the owner understood how poorly what was in place was protecting his structure. It was not in his technical ability to understand that. We've only been on the case since about January, and we very quickly saw that it was insufficient to defend the structure from the elements, but we hadn't actually a very good appreciation for just how bad things were until much more recently. City staff are to be commended for how quickly they've helped us out, how they've responded to this situation. And really the long and the short of the question of the situation is that this structure, given the permits right now, if we carry out the work that is before the committee, we shouldn't see continuing deterioration. Once we enclose this in an effective building envelope, protect it and heat it, whether it's rebuilt this year or next, and I mean the owner is very much wanting to do work this summer. There's a bit of a misunderstanding as to how long it takes to get going with all the required permits, but his intention is to have this reconstructed in short order. In fact, we have a meeting on Thursday talking about getting our structural set ready to protect or to support the architectural set. To which point, Madam Chair, the only reason the work that was permitted in 2013 didn't go ahead was that there was never the production of a structural set which could support the architectural set. So the heritage permit is issued against an architectural picture of what the owner wants to achieve.
But you can't build from a simple architectural set. You have to have both architectural and structural sets, as well as supporting mechanical, electrical, and civil, and landscaping. There are other allied professionals involved, but fundamentally, the issuing of a heritage permit does not then give the owner the ability to go and build what he wants. So I want to make sure that the councillors understand that the owner wasn't actually in a position to continue. He never had a structural engineering set that he could build from, which was really where all of this became a problem after all of the goodwill of 2013.
Well, thank you for that. Does Frank or Matthew, do you have comment on that, as far as to what the comments he was making about the missing link, if you will?
Unfortunately, no. I don't have a lot of the prior history with respect to the 2013 development. We did not see any movement on that project, and really, I think it was. I think the information that was provided is somewhat enlightening also to myself.
Thank you. Questions of our delegation, Councillor Blay.
Thanks very much, and thanks for coming here today. You've articulated the reasons why work couldn't go forward in 2013, the missing structural and allied professions. So I guess my question is, does the owner have that now, or will he have it in short order?
Thank you. Madam Chair, I can tell you that we are working now, as we speak, on a structural set, supporting the architectural set that everyone, including members of the public, have very much liked from 2013, and we hope to move forward with that in short order. It would be a matter of getting those plans into the city, reviewed, and out. One of our recommendations we were making in our report was that there be an accelerated process of review, and I think that the city staff are on board for that type of thing. We very much want this project to complete. I think you can appreciate that the owner has no intention of turning this into a parking lot. It's much more valuable to him as a finished heritage structure, and I believe it to be a point of pride for the owner to restore this building to its honest glory. He very much wants to do so.
Well, he wouldn't be allowed to turn into a parking lot anyway, so. But I can tell you that those, I remember the renditions we saw in 2013 that were before this committee, and they were very well received. So what's taken him so long? And why should we believe you now?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Effectively, what occurred was that the previous structural engineering firm completed a set of drawings in support of the architect to a certain point, and then demanded a change. There were two conflicting reports from geotechnical engineers, and as a result, this sort of confusing inputs into the system then created a situation where there was a professional dispute as to how to go forward. I suppose it'd be probably a bit too much information if I get into a great deal of detail, but think about it in terms of a dispute as to how best to rebuild the structure. And the architect had completed their drawings to the point where you could construct architecturally from those drawings and resisted the changes that the structural engineer at the time was requesting, I'd even say so far as to demand. And as a result, the owner was faced with the architect saying, if I'm going to redesign this, you're going to pay me. And the structural engineer saying, I've given you 66% drawings, and now I'm told by my geotech colleague that I can't continue with what I've given you. I have to change gears to something else. He wants more money. The architect wants more money. It sort of dwindled into a dispute. One of the reasons why we've been brought on board by the owner is that we actually agree with the original set. We believe we can support the original architectural set with a competent structural set and allow the owner to go forward without having to effectively pay twice for his architectural.
Well, thank you for that. And Ms. Kutz has made a commitment that as soon as you do have the application in, that we'll deal with that promptly. Ms. Kutz?
Madam Chair, though, I have to remind the committee that that permit has expired, so it will have to go through a whole new application under the Ontario Heritage Act to be considered by Built Heritage Subcommittee, Planning Committee, and Council.
How long will that take?
Madam Chair, it will. The Heritage Act requires that it's approved within 90 days of the receipt of a final application. But as you know, our track record is very good at taking a lot less time than 90 days. Mm-hmm. So I would expect it could be done quite quickly.
So there's nothing to stop that application going forward in the ahead of what Mr. Quinn's talking about?
No, but of course, that's just a heritage permit. All the building permits under the Building Code Act, et cetera, and it probably at that point, site plan and other planning applications have to go ahead. But again, I think there's deep commitment to getting all the permits in place so this project can be underway as soon as possible.
Yeah, I doubt very much there's anybody at the city or even in the neighborhood or even in the city that knows about this situation wouldn't want it to go forward as quickly as possible. There certainly is a will for that. Councillor Cloutier? Mr. Quinn?
Yeah.
Mr. Quinn?
Okay. Yes. Mr. Quinn, you said that you can't build from architectural drawings, but then in response you said that you're ready to build from the architectural drawings. Was that based on, if you could clarify that for me.
Sorry, so Madam Chair, that's actually, again, a level of sort of detail. The architectural enclosure of a structure, the protection of the structure ultimately against wind, rain, and other deleterious elements, that is architectural, and you do build those types of elements directly from an architectural set. A company who specialize in building envelope work or flashing roofers, those people work from architectural sets. But the substance of a structure, which is missing walls and footings and beams and foundations, the first thing you do is build from the structural set. Footings, columns, tie beams, floor systems, walls, all of those details come from the structural set, which was missing. So while it's true to say, and I didn't mean to misspeak in a way that would be confusing, but it's true to say that you could build from the architectural set the owner had, but you can't build from that set those details which come from architectural sets until you have the structural set and complete the work from that structural set. Electrical and mechanical things can go afterwards, but structure comes before architectural.
And that's because of the current condition of the building.
It's because of basically any structure of any sort if you want to be building, but yes.
But if you're renovating.
If you're renovating, you'd often be able to build portions from the architectural directly right away.
So you spoke of professional disagreement from an engineering point of view, and you've just come on in January. Have those, and you indicated a certain level of comfort with the state. You'll be able to build from the structural sets that you have, or you've adjusted them to your.
Madam Chair, we'll be creating a structural set in support of the architectural set. We tried to get the past structural work from the previous engineer. There were, let's call them, court responses based on his opinion of the owner, and we weren't able to do so. But we've replaced what we needed to replace in order to progress this site to the point where it would be safe for the public to be adjacent to the structure, and we are actively working to replace the structural sets which previously existed with our own structural design in support of a pre-existing architectural that everybody likes. So the architect really is the lead in these sorts of situations. An architect decides how large the space will be, how many stairs, how many toilets, how much public space, how much confined space. All of those things are sort of pre-screened and proportioned by an architect. After that, a structural engineer takes, and ideally what you want from the architect is a completed set. In many ways, what we're getting is a Cadillac problem for a structural engineer. We have an architect who is giving us a complete set of finished drawings, who's telling me everywhere everything has to be, and I can work from that. That's a beautiful thing for a structural engineer, because most of the time our fees and our efforts get swallowed by people moving walls 1 or 2 feet. They don't have an understanding or an appreciation that by moving a wall 2 feet, for a structural engineer you've changed everything, and I have to go back and redo all of my work. That shouldn't happen here. We should be able to produce our structural set quickly to a known standard set by a very well-reputed architect and produce a design which should go quickly through the city, and then go, ideally, quickly to construction. And if I may add, construction in this country, people jokingly say we have winter and construction. In many ways, that's quite true, but it's not true of a site like this where we have to be continuously heating with salamanders. Those are large propane gas
flamethrowers, for lack of a better euphemism. And because we're actively heating, I expect we will be in construction this winter.
Does anyone have any other questions for Mr. Quinn? No, I was just going to say, when you were talking, it sounds like, I think, probably a couple of years ago, people would go kind of like, don't know what you're talking about, but anybody who watches any of the home renovation shows, okay, we absolutely get what that decision of taking down that wall, that's the structure-bearing wall, et cetera, from tiny houses to old mansions that they're renovating. It's an interesting, your comments were very interesting. So thank you. I think that's it for questions. So Councillor Brockington does have a question of staff. And while he is asking that, I'll ask Mr. Jeans to come forward, who is the president of Heritage Ottawa.
Just so I can sleep at night, could staff please clarify what safety precautions are being taken now to ensure the building doesn't fall down on anyone walking by on the sidewalk? If the building is in such poor shape and it has to be torn down because of the shape it's in, what are we doing to ensure that, is the south-facing sidewalk closed right now to pedestrians?
We had city services go out last week, or 2 weeks ago now, I guess, and close down the sidewalk to restrict public access along that side. As part of the process for moving forward on the demolition, that side of the street will be hoarded right up to the sidewalk during the construction phase. And then at completion of construction phase, the site left over, the open excavation in behind will be hoarded, and the sidewalk will be reopened.
So is the most risky part from basically where the steel frame is, not the actual brick building on the right, but everything on the left?
Sally can put her cursor on the most, it's the fourth bay of the three-story portion is right there. That is the most serious portion of the building right now.
Okay.
But that is the portion that we're planning to retain as much as possible. Once they start demolition, we'll see how much they can.
But you can assure us between now and then we are not putting members of the public at risk who are in this vicinity.
Right, exactly. That is our primary focus. We want to make sure that people don't get in that area at all.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Jeans, welcome.
Thank you, Chair. We had a long discussion at Built Heritage Subcommittee yesterday. Many of my Heritage Ottawa colleagues were in the audience supporting me because we've been involved with this building over the whole history since 2008 and before. We regretted the loss of an important part of the east portion of the building in 2008. We regret the total loss that you're going to approve today of that part of the building, and we deeply regret that we are now losing part of the original 1899 building, though with the motion that was passed by Built Heritage Subcommittee yesterday, we hope that it will be accurately restored, that it will be properly recorded, and that sufficient materials will be retained from the demolition to make that reconstruction possible. But we felt that we should not have got to the position that we're in today, and that feeling was, I believe, shared by the committee. We've had many examples of what we call demolition by neglect. You know very well the situation of Our Lady School at the corner of Murray and Cumberland, which became not only the loss of most of a heritage structure, but also a public safety hazard requiring the total closure of the sidewalk there and until that could be completely stabilized. Back in 2008, this building was stabilized and was safe. But today we are facing a safety issue where further deterioration of the supported wall and deterioration of part of the wall that didn't require support back in 2008 has now led to a public safety issue. The problem here is that the property standards bylaw that was passed by council in 2013 has heritage clauses which are designed to prevent this sort of thing happening. designed to make sure that heritage buildings that are vacant or damaged are properly secured against damage from the elements, and that was not done in this case. I'm not going to speak to persons in this case, but I will say that in 2013 we were very pleased with the development proposal, which this committee approved. We thought that it was good. It reused as much as possible of what had been preserved from 2008. And it respected the 1899 design of the building, yet producing a useful modern reuse of the structure. We still hope to see that, but we do feel that we've had too many cases of demolition by neglect, and that council must ensure that the bylaw that it passed in 2013 is observed and is applied in these cases. We've had many other such cases. 7 Clarence Street, which you're aware of, which is in a very bad state right now, has been demolished, and yet there's even more damage that has appeared in the NCC moving to reconstruct that building. 110 to 116 Spark Street, where again it wasn't possible to save any of the brickwork, though some of the window materials are being saved for the project which is underway right now. The Kaplan storefront on Rideau Street, this is going back a few years, where none of the brickwork could be saved, and what had to be resorted to was the creation of a replica facade with completely new bricks. And the Ogilvy's store facade, where in fact only, in the end, only about 25% of the original facade was able to be saved and reconstructed, reusing bricks from the much larger walls that were demolished there. So we feel from a heritage point of view the property standards bylaw is not being applied, and that's a serious problem in this case, quite apart from all the other elements. So I'm going to finish there. I'd be glad to answer any questions, but this building is really, in a sense, the line in the sand on application of the property standards bylaw.
So thank you, Mr. Jeans. And earlier on, when we came to this item, you heard the conversation about staff believing that they have enough legislative approval that they need to coordinate better within. Mm-hmm. You must be pleased then with that they're going to come back in the fall with further details on how to do that. Mm-hmm. From a legal perspective, from other pressures we can apply, perhaps with securities and that sort of thing, looking at our planning process, so making it far more holistic. And so I would think that must please you to hear that. Mm-hmm. Okay, anyone have any questions for Mr. Jeans? Well, thank you for coming out today. Okay, so we'll come back into committee. Anyone have any comments? Or we do have a motion that comes from Built Heritage yesterday. And Vice Chair Tierney has that. So they did change the recommendation. They added quite a bit. You do have that one before you. 10 items on it, right? So that's what he's going to be referring
Great.
To.
Great. Thank you, Madam Chair. There's 4 pages here, and 2 of them are the therefore it be resolved clauses, so everyone get cozy. Therefore it be resolved that Planning Committee approve and forward to Council the amended recommendations of Built Heritage Subcommittee with respect to the report as follows. That the Planning Committee recommended to Council 1. Approve the controlled demolition of the fourth bay and the 3-story structure generally in accordance with the plans received on June 9, 2016, conditional upon the concurrence of the Chief Building Officer regards to the method to be followed with the execution of the proposed removal. 2. Impose the terms and condition of the controlled demolition of the fourth bay and the 3-story structure that every effort be made to retain the historic fabric of the situ, and the retention of the situ is not possible. The application shall make every effort to rebuild the wall using the materials from the original building according to the plans developed in the construction with the application. Heritage staff and chief building official is part of the process leading to the issuance of the building permit. 3. Approval of demolition of the 3 east bays of the structural general accordance with the plans received on June 9, 2016, conditional upon the concurrence of the chief building officer in regards to the methods being followed in the demolition. 4. Approval
approved the stabilization of the north and east foundations of the structure in accordance with the plans received on June 9, 2016, conditional upon the concurrence of the chief building office official regarding the methods followed by the execution of the proposed stabilization. Number five, impose a term and conditions on said approvals. Where possible, the applicant will be required to clean store bricks, stone elements, and decorative metal that may be used elsewhere in the repair and restoration of the building. Number six, delegated authority.
Number six.